All right, everyone, welcome to the latest episode ng Meta Deep Dive. Paiba-iba yung pangalan natin, but more or less, you know what you're gonna get out of this podcast natin. It's always gonna be a combination of substance and a little bit of entertainment. Sometimes sumasobrang entertainment, we can't help it. Kasama natin today someone who I haven't seen for a long time. It's been a while. Admiral Romel Ong. Kamusta po kayo dyan over the past 21 hours?
Okay, long time no see.
Long time no see, Admiral. Yeah, I mean, of course, one of the greatest pleasures of this podcast that I built over the past 2 years since election 2022 is creating a sense of community. And nung isang araw dun sa ating UTAC forum, just to be clear, hindi tayo nagpaparinig na walang ano yung kabila. Ito yung usapan, Taft at Katipunan. You know, I mean, na-feel ko yung sense of community natin, Admiral. Did you feel our sense of community, Admiral?
Medyo,
no, it's not a trick question. It's not a trick question. Diba? All stars.
Kasi, wala naman ako access dun sa chat room eh. So, parang hindi ko nakikita yung
interview
with the audience.
No, the audience are still quiet and waiting. Now, Admiral, I was wondering, you know, of course, Secretary Llamas, Justice Carpio, have been in conversation for quite some time. So it was good to have all of us under one roof. Although very small room, tight room. Mas marami pa yung media kaysa space doon, no? It was crazy. It was crazy. It was full. Now, Admiral, obviously, you know, speaking of friendship, we can talk about lots of friendship and or not so friendships sa West Philippine Sea. Admiral, have you followed yung latest hearing in sa Senate? Meron palang libro si Sara Duterte, self-authored. Hindi ko alam kung dumaan sa peer review to. Isang kaibigan ang title yata. Yung mga balaurang tao, ginawa nilang isang kaibigan. Tapos yung parrot, Kiboloy, sabi niya, kaibigan ni Kiboloy, sabi nung kabilang owl, kaibigan niya ng China. Meron pang version, yung gagastos ka sa 11 days, ang grabe talaga. Guys, don't be like that. Admiral, speaking of friendship, wait lang, hindi ba strange for Duterte, especially Sara Duterte to talk about friendship? I mean, have you heard something about this, Admiral? Na may libro siyang ganyan.
Medyo off yung situation. To say the least.
Parang ang bilis pala maging best-selling author. Kailangan mo lang mag-DepEd pala. Mag-DepEd secretary ka. Pwede na tayo lahat mag-best-selling author. Kalain mo yung budget daw, 10 million pesos. Sarap buhay. Sarap buhay talaga. Author na ngayon. Author. Ayan na naman tayo, Justice Carpio. Matatanggal talaga.
Bilangan na katalag for once now.
Basta, kaibigan tayo. Kaibigan ako ni Justice Carpio. Kaibigan ako ni Admiral Ong. Admiral, ito. Pag-usapan natin, obviously, latest in the West Philippine Sea, itong nakakabahala ng development sa nakita natin sa Sabina Shoal. At of course, yung direction of bilateral relationships natin. But honestly, the reason I ask about Duterte and all of that, because during that hearing, ayan, serious na tayo, Admiral. During that hearing, Sara Duterte had this weird tangential thing na, ito si Risa, binabanatan kami mga Duterte dun sa speech niya sa Akbay. Wow, stalker, di ba? Na ano kami ng China, ganun. Admiral, do you think the Chinese see the Dutertes as their friends? Speaking of isang kaibigan, sa tingin mo ba sila bang isang kaibigan ng China sa Pilipinas, Admiral?
Well, I think looking back to the previous administration, that would fit the description, kaibigan talaga nila.
Sige, you're free not to self-incriminate and let me take the punches and all of that. Pinapainit natin kasi alam mo naman, Admiral, di ba, pag sa klase, minsan maaga ka mag-start. Paparating lang yung mga estudyante. So, pumapasok pa lang yung mga estudyante. Ito yung warm-up lang ng pre-lecture discussion natin. Admiral, now, I mean, going back to this, the reason I raised that also is because dun sa forum natin sa UTAC, pinag-usapan po natin, Admiral, yung issue ng misinformation, malign influence, of course, nabubuking na yung mga ibang fake journalists ng China na kunyaring journalist, yung pala iba yung ginagawa. So, I mean, how serious is You know, the presence of openly pro-China elements or not so patriotic elements na tahimik that pagdating sa West Philippine Sea, in terms of making sure na magkaroon tayo ng national coherence, alignment, at saka effective response dun sa threat na meron tayo sa West Philippine Sea, which we'll discuss more as we move forward, Admiral. How serious are these friends of China, if I can put it that way, yung mga isang kaibigan ng China sa Pilipinas? How much of a, gaano sila kasagabal sa pagbuo ng isang united front sa Pilipinas pagdating sa yung ating laban sa West Philippine Sea?
Well, I think mahihirapan naman tayo magbuo ng 100% everybody is on the same page as far as West Philippine Sea is concerned. Eh. Number one, by the nature of the beast, yung politics natin, talaga namang otak-otak tayo. May kanya-kanyang partido yun. Eh. May kanya-kanyang interest. Eh. So if we aspire for yung 100% unified position on the say West Philippine Sea, medyo malabo yon. Pero at least we have, I think, 90 or 91% eh, based on yung previous surveys na we had. So I think that's already good na as far as we're concerned. Now, hindi rin natin may iwasan na these actors, these political actors within our community, magagamit yan ang ating katunggali, yung China. It may be the relationship might be ideological. Sabi nga ni, ano, ni Secretary Llamas, it could be transactional or it could be purely a personal personal view ng tao na ano, naniniwala siya na tama yung kanyang ano, pananaw sa buhay. So that's a matter of personal opinion. Hindi mo pwedeng itanggalin sa kanya. So, we have to live with it na divided yung country. Ang ano na lang dito yung metrics natin is how divided are we. So if it's a 91%, 9% yung labanan natin, I think we can be comfortable with that percentage.
Yeah, I mean, just to be clear, of course, Admiral, no one is talking about like North Korea-style unison of view, di ba? I mean, what we're talking about is yung minimum, yung acceptables. Kasi, for instance, sa US, Admiral, the Democrats and Republicans disagree on so many things. But at least in terms of the facts of anong kailangan ng US pagdating sa kanyang national interest, making sure na walang interference, you know, sa kanilang elections, ganun. There's a great degree, hindi ko na lang pag-usapan si Trump, pero there's a great degree of, let's just call it, bipartisan consensus. Yeah. Diba? Ang labanan lang naman dyan yung tactics eh. Siyempre, Democrats want to go multilateralist, the Republicans want to go more unilateralist, but at the end of the day, for instance, tanggap nila yung China yung number one threat sa kanilang global leadership or hegemony, whatever you want to call it. So, ang siguro ang pinag-usapan natin dito is, not na, I mean, obviously, in any democracy, there's a plurality of views. But in terms of yung agreement on the basic facts of the matter, I think Justice Scarpio kept on mentioning that. But dapat align tayo at least dun sa basic facts, including, siguro naman, gusto natin labanan yung bullying sa West Philippines, di ba? So I think that's the context. So how is malign influence different from legitimate, pluralistic, democratic discourse or debate or even disagreement?
Well, dito na tayo papasok sa ano eh, yung larangan ng foreign interference eh, or foreign malign influence which you mentioned. That means they will, let's say for example, China will employ political actors, domestic political actors, as best nila for spreading yung, number one, yung narrative nila. Pangalawa, which is I think we should be worried about, is yung potential disruption niya during our 2025 elections. Kasi we have to anticipate that will be a battleground for itong US, yung Philippine-China problem sa West Philippine Sea. Mag-spill over yan sa 2025 elections natin. Kasi if we go Sun Tzu, okay, the best way of not winning without fighting is actually co-opting yung political katunggali mo.
Kaya yung psychological warfare is the most important thing to them, no, Admiral? That's why psychological warfare is so important for China.
Correct. Yeah.
It's the cheapest but the most high impact. Parang ganun. Low cost, high impact.
Kasi when you talk of psychological warfare, ang tinitiran niya yung ano eh, yung will to fight. Yung moral will to fight ng citizens ng kabilang bansa. Okay. You compel the other country or yung adversary mo to actually accede or appease to your position.
Admiral, I'll push you a little bit on this, no? So there are two layers to this, no? One is pagdating sa mga perceptions of China at saka West Philippine Sea, nakikita natin ang laki ng agwat ng opinion sa Mindanao, especially yung mga parts ng Mindanao na malapit sa Davao, etc. At yung kabuuan ng ating bansa. So there seems to be kind of a geographic divide in terms of views of China, and siguro makinalaman yan sa mga Dutertes. But secondly, and more directly related to Duterte's, hindi ko alam, Admiral, anong basa mo dito. During time of Digong, I met two kinds of DDS. Actually, I wrote about five kinds of DDS, including yung mga technocrats na nakikisaka, yung mga opportunists, yung mga, but dun sa mga, yung mga authentic, I mean, sincere na DDS, if I can put it that way. Yung iba sa kanila, Admiral, siguro nakilala tayo back in the day, lalapit sa, alam mo, Prof, mahal na mahal ko yan si Digong, palaban yan, pero bakit sa China ganun po siya? So, sa akin sila humingi ng explanation na alam nila critical pa ako kay Duterte na bakit ganun, Prof? Di ba dapat ganun? Oh. And then yung iba, and I think there's still a lot of them, is hindi, whatever Duterte says is the truth, di ba? May medyo catechistic na eh. I mean, I don't want to use the word kulto, pero may pagkaganon na whatever Duterte says, yun na yun, di ba? So if Duterte says, US yung kalaban, China yung kaibigan, then yun na yun. So kaya nga, para sa akin, it's not like we're starting from scratch eh. We are recovering from 6 years of Duterte disinformation or Duterte dissonance, if I can put it. And then right now, meron pa rin mga divide eh. Nakita ko yung SW surveys, for instance, on views of West Philippines, si 2022 pa lang, among others. And in-explain ni mga ahas yan, yung my fellow columnist at Philippine Daily Inquirer, ang layo ng Mindanao points of view eh. Again, you can go sub-regional in Mindanao, so I'm sorry to our Mindanao friends, I'm not trying to generalize. But ikaw, Admiral, what is your read on that? Kasi it looks like differential yung impact ng misinformation or disinformation. Hindi siya even, di ba? Oh.
I would like to factor another aspect. May ibang possibility. Well, of course, andun yung influence of the Dutertes sa Mindanao, no? But we have to recall na Mindanao has experienced violence from violent extremism, tapos yung terrorism, and it impacts yung communities nila doon. So maybe pag binalansin natin, ay magkakaroon pa tayo ng farm elections. So pag winiin mo ano yung mas compelling na problem sa kanila, baka yung local dynamics nung yung effects, post-conflict effects, trying to recover from that, mas magwe-weigh in yun compared to sa West Philippine Sea.
Yung
Now,
immediacy, what you're saying is the immediacy and the historical trauma kind of prevents some of our kababayan from fully seeing yung threat coming from the outside. Yun yung sinasabi po nyo. I
kasi
see your point. I see your point. Good point.
kasi mas impactful yun eh. Naranasan nila yun eh. Biro mo, you're living with Abu Sayyaf, you're living with secessionism, and most likely affected yung communities mo by yung labanan between state and non-state actors. So mas visual sa iyo yun, mas mararamdaman mo. And kita mo yun, apektado ka. Ngayon, pag sinabi West Philippines, baka sa from a Mindanao lens, baka parang ano pa yun eh, parang it's a concept or an idea, pero hindi mo maramdaman yung
Mas
epekto.
abstract siya kaysa visceral or
Correct.
immediate. Gets ko yan. Gets ko yan. That's a very good point. I do not completely, I do not disagree at all. Siguro ang isa pa lang dito is ano yung mas wagi, no, dun sa mga factors niya, ano yung mas malaking factors, no. Admiral, before going to the latest in the West Philippine Sea, no, honestly, kayo po bilang isang patriot, former top naval serviceman, how did you feel during the Duterte time, if it's okay to ask you? Ako, I don't come from a military background, pero bilang isang eskolar ng bayan, isang UP graduate, bilang ana, para I felt offended na grabe naman to, parang walang self-respect itong presidente natin. Grabe, I would imagine 10 times worse yung sakit sa yung na mas masakit doon sa ating mga sundalo, sa mga taong katulad.
Richard, na-mute ka. Na-mute.
Na-mute na ako. Can you hear me now, Admiral? Can you hear me, Admiral? Bakit na-mute ako? Now, can you hear me, Admiral? Ah, wait lang.
Kaya na, meron na. Meron na. Anong
Sinasabot.
nangyari?
Wait lang. Admiral, I'll admit, for a second, I thought parang ayaw masagutin yung tanong mo. Like, hello, hello,
Hello,
I
wala.
can't hear you. Shush, shush. Ginaganong ko si Secretary Liamat. No, baka may internet connection issue. Admiral, just to ask you about it, how did you feel during the Duterte time when he was saying all of those things na hindi tugma dun sa ating national interest, to put it mildly?
Okay, well, I think may connectivity issues ka ta. Talaga, ano. Well, we were personally, I was uncomfortable kasi parang ano eh, parang meron kang ethical dilemma. You're supposed to, number one, defend yung country mo. You're supposed to protect your people. Tapos you receive these instructions na, okay, bawal magpatrolya ng West Philippine Sea o ng beyond its economic zone. Hindi mo pwede gawin ito. Tapos yung ating alyansa with the US is already parang ano something that needs to be shelved. Okay. So iba yung ano eh iba yung dynamics sa Navy kasi with the rest of the armed forces, kasi the rest of the armed forces naman was focused on counterinsurgency. So parang okay lang, tuloy-tuloy lang naman yung ano eh. But for the Navy, kasi ang mission namin is to protect yung ating yung karagatan. That poses an ethical dilemma na parang meron kang mandato para gawin yun. And there is no it should be agnostic in terms of politics. It is a mandate that you perform regardless kung sino yung nakaupo. But for yung nakaupo na yon to say na hindi mo pwede gawin ito, kasi it's against yung policy ako, kasi it will affect our relations with China. Para merong ano, merong problematic para sa amin.
So Admiral, obviously, sorry, I forgot for a moment na nag-overlap. You were still in service, no? During some of these years. So anong year po kayo nag-retire from service?
2019.
2019. So you had more or less still 3 years. So yung first 3 years ni Digong na pinakamahirap, no? Or at least the first 3-4 years andun pa sa service. To the degree that you can share with us, Admiral, totoo ba na talagang pinapasupress ng admin dati yung mga pangyayari sa West Philippine Sea? Totoo ba na talagang in a way parang piniprevent kayo from exercising your duties? To the degree that you can share, I mean, how bad was it?
It's not so much yung ano eh, kasi hindi naman yan ano eh, nakasulat na bawal pong gawin yan. It's nasa ano yun eh. Yung you can sense naman yung ano eh.
Yung coordinates of
direction eh, by direction, or yung gusto mangyari sa taas eh. There are things that we can perform, but there are things na hindi mo pwede gawin. Ang major na tinamaan doon is yung ano eh, yung informing the public of what's happening. So minsan nadidelay yan, minsan after 3 months or after 4 months doon pala nalalabas, okay, nagkaroon ng incident dito sa I remember yung ano, there was one incident yung when the aircraft carrier ng China, yung Liaoning, passed by Cebu to Strait. It was several months before it was ano, the public was informed may nangyari ng incident. So it was suppressed in a way.
Now, and that was not an exercise of innocent passage, no? Kasi naka-on yung radar and weapon systems niya, di ba? Or actually, enough niya yata yung signal niya, di ba? Na parang surreptitious. They did something fishy, yeah.
Well, you can say na they were not violating ano, yung international law. Kasi, number one, international street naman yung Cebu to Strait. Eh. So, expeditious, we presume, expeditious yung kanyang transit to our internal waters. But aside from international law, there is a thing as ano, yung parang practice among navies, eh. Particularly as it affects the Philippines. Pag may mga foreign navies, so international navies coming into our archipelago, normally, nagre-request yan ng diplomatic clearance. Eh. As a courtesy. Okay? But for this, ano, yung for this type of incidents, they just pass through our waters walang pasintabi. So when you ask the embassy, yung embassy nila, ano nangyari, sabihin nila, sasabihin nila, they were also not informed. Okay. So meron mga ganun insidente.
So that's why transparency initiative is very important, no? That's where the value of transparency initiative comes in, because yun yung talagang missing ng panahon ni Digong, di ba?
Yes. Ang ganito yung ano eh, parang ganito yung logic dun eh. Kung hindi tayo maingay noong time na yun, ang theory doon is hindi ka maingay, then hindi yung you can do other things within the West Philippine Sea na hindi mag-create ng violent reaction from the Chinese. Okay, so yun yung theory nung ano eh, nung sinusuppress mo information na yun. But the thing is, hindi naman napigil yung ano eh, coercive activities nila eh, sa West Philippine Sea. Tuloy-tuloy lang yun. So yung konsepto na kung tahimik ka, hindi rin sila gagalaw at hindi rin sila mag-aharas ng ating mga mamamayan, hindi rin naman nangyari yun. And it create a parang safe space sa kanila eh. Which nararamdaman na natin yung epekto. Kasi we created the safe space para mag-expand sila to our exclusive economic zone. Ngayon, kinoconfront natin, nandiyan na sila. Okay. So, nahihirapan tayo mag-pushback eh. Kasi naka-ano na sila eh. More or less, nakasettle lang sila within our internal waters. Well, within our exclusive economic zone. Kaya if we are to,
right.
Yung first step talaga natin dito is, kung babalikan natin, we need to be present also. We need to establish, we need to restore yung presensya natin sa dagat natin.
Right. Apologies lang, Admiral. I'm thinking, looks like there's some network issues. I don't know. Lahat ng tao ay nag-urge ng check, para I'll check yung network. Mukhang lahat may network connection in the area, no? So hindi ko kasalanan. I thought sinasabotage tayo eh. But at least I think on your part, things are looking better compared to my side. Admiral, pag-usapan natin, I mean, again, I know, you know, your expertise is really on naval West Philippine Sea issues, but anong read mo na if etong mga impeachment things against Sara, all of these ICC things, all of these things move forward, do you think this could lead to instability that could undermine the country, or do you think na whatever happens, we can still hold this together, or if anything, actually the country can come out better out of this itong hidwa ng mga malalaking pamilya or dynasties?
Ang kung ikakabit lang natin sa West Philippine Sea, ang nakita ko lang potential diyan is of course yung it will create some political tension within the country. So that political tension creates a vulnerability for us that can be exploitable. Okay? So hindi natin maano, but again, we do not go through that process kasi we need to confront the problem. Okay? At some point there needs to be some form of hindi naman retribution, no? But
clean up.
We need to examine, okay, ano yung nangyari and ano yung implication ng ginawa nila for the past few years. Okay, ano yung na-violate nilang batas. Okay. So we need to go through the process of confrontation para makamove on tayo.
Again, so on one hand, you're saying, Admiral, na ito ay, it is what it is. We have to go through this process kung talaga there's grounds to questioning conduct ng mga Duterte, whether as president or vice president currently. But don't you think also this process could be a kind of a mobilizing catalyst or catalyst for a better understanding ano yung mga, yung minimum na kailangan natin bilang isang bansa? I mean, in a way, what I'm saying is, hindi ba siguro magkaroon din ng opportunity out of this crisis for the Philippines to figure out ano ba talagang gusto niya, ano talagang kailangan niyang gawin?
Kung babalikan natin yung past 6 years, we went through a populist regime. Eh. And tapos ang daming inallow na laws to be violated. Even tayo rin eh, as citizens, eh, we need to examine why did we, kasi in a way, party tayo rin. If we kept silent, or hinayaan natin, we are also party to that question of ano ba yung mga accountability, ano ba yung accountability natin as a citizen. Okay, tayo bilang citizen, tayo lahat, ano yung accountability natin for allowing certain law to be violated during those past 6 years?
And also understanding what are these laws and bakit andun yung mga batas na yan, di ba? Na why you can't make just secret agreements, bakit dapat may certain degree of transparency, dapat may multi-stakeholder interaction. Kasi the reason I'm saying this is, Admiral, I think there is, ngayon lang natin nakikita yung clear contrasts of views, no? Na kung saan talaga, you know, some of the biggest families, dynasties in the country are openly questioning each other's point of view dun sa ating national interest, diba? I mean, the Dutertes are the most outspoken critics of what some understand as a kind of a normal Philippine foreign policy. And as far as President Marcos is concerned, he's also very proactive in pushing for an understanding of the Philippines as a rising middle power, a more independent, multi-aligned foreign policy. So, in a sense, ako, para sa akin, ngayon nakikita natin na nagkakaroon ng clear articulation and clear fault lines and distinctions na wala dati. Kasi dati, trapo-trapo lang, di ba? Anyone will just say, you know, motherhood statements. Kaya very clear na yung distinction. I mean, I would have expected that to happen if former President Aquino, God bless his soul, I mean, if he were actively opposing Duterte in his earlier years, eh, hindi nangyari yun. I mean, he chose, you know, dignified silence na lang. But now, talagang you can see the clear contrast. Walang dignified, neither dignity nor silent si Digong, di ba? Openly kine-question niya and he provides an alternative narrative. Some would even say propaganda or disinformation. While President Marcos also very actively insists na tama yung ginagawa niya and he has to be supported accordingly. So look at the SONA speech of Marcos or international speeches niya and then titignan mo yung mga sinasabi ni Duterte sa SMNI, whatever. So now you have a clear contrast between two major figures in Philippine politics in a way we didn't have before, right? So there's now more room for strategic discussion.
Whether you support either of the families, the fact that we are having this public debate, I think it's good for the country. Nagkakaroon ng participation yung citizens natin, yung masa. And we all learn from this. I think we will all learn from this, yung process na ito. Whether masaktan tayo hindi kasi meron tayong pinapanigan tapos nakikita natin yung pinapanigan natin parang later na kikwestiyon tama ba yung position ko doon o ngayon. Okay. Kasi kung hindi natin gagawin yung proseso na yan, parang we swept under the rug yung nangyari before eh. And that creates the possibility na mangyari ulit.
Kasi sa ibang bansa, di ba, Admiral, what happened is they had wars or they have clear and present danger, whether this is South Korea, North Korea, Taiwan, China. I can go on and on, di ba? Tayo kasi, because of our geography, you know, yes, there was the World War II and all, pero we always had a degree of insulation from direct military threat or occupation, di ba? In ways that many of our neighbors never had. So in that sense, strategic culture, sigurang din ang issue dito. No? We never developed a kind of a sophisticated strategic culture because there was always the US and also the vast waters and oceans to protect us.
Well, yung geography natin created a certain level of complacency on our part. As you are correct, we never developed a strategic culture kasi we were never in a situation as a community, as a nation, no? Na parang under threat tayo. Yung existence natin can be mawala lang just a matter of hours or days. So we never had that that fear. Okay? We never had that fear na pwede tayong tamaan anytime. So because of that complacency, mahaba yung PC natin. Kung napapansin mo, mahaba yung PC natin. Even if dihado na tayo, balik natin yung discussion ng West Philippines. Dihado na tayo sa dagat and mahaba pa rin yung PC natin.
So, in what ways do you think we're moving in the right direction, Admiral? I mean, of course, we're having our own little conversations here. We have our OTAC forum, all of these things. But in what ways pwede pa tayo tumulong lalo, Admiral, pagdating sa development of that strategic culture? Gaano kalaking role ng public thinkers, influencers for that matter, and journalists in that matter.
Well, I think yung ginagawa mo, Richard, is the correct trajectory for this discussion. Let open up to public discourse. Tapos, of course, when we communicate, make it, kumbaga, maintindihan ng masa, maintindihan ng tao, yung issues. Okay? Binababa natin yung level of discourse para ano eh, para makahabo lahat. Okay. Kasi one of, I think if I recall, one of the questions ng media, ng forum natin ng isang araw was yung discussion natin ng West Philippine Sea is not a bread and butter issue. Hindi siya gut level issue. But I think what we responded to that and say, hindi, ganito yan eh. It's a bread and butter issue. If you look at it from this perspective of certain aspects of human security na tinatamaan. Okay? So again, when this forum provides us the venue to elucidate or to explain better yung nuances ng problem. As opposed to yung parang abstract concept siya, hindi mag-gets ng ano eh, hindi mag-gets ng ating mga mamamayan eh. Kasi parang hindi naman nila kinoconfront yung ano, on a daily basis.
I mean, obviously, unavoidable, Admiral, na medyo magkakaroon ng konting abstract strategic thinking. It's just part of the business. Pero siguro yung challenge dito is communicating, no? Public communications in ways na, makikita ng tao talaga na may bread and butter implication ito in this sense. In this case, isda, di ba? Hindi lang apektado yung ating mangingista, apektado yung food security natin, apektado din of course yung energy security natin dahil hindi natin ma-develop yung reed bank, for instance. I mean, imagine kung wala yung bullying ng China, eh matagal na sana natin na-develop yung reed bank, di ba? Eh di sana mas mura ngayon ang electricity, eh di sana mas murang lahat, di ba? So may inflationary impact yan. So yun ang problema, eh, hindi na-discuss na mabuti. At yun din ang sinabi ko, Admiral, dun sa forum natin na hindi rin pinag-usapan ng mabuti ano yung cost ng ginagawa ng China. Ilan daan milyon ang nawawala sa atin, ilang billion dollars bawat taon nawawala sa atin dahil sa illegal fishing ng China. Ilan billion ang nawawala sa atin dahil hindi natin ma-develop yung reed bank, oil and gas resources, not to mention yung mga ibang areas. So I think kulang tayo sa communications and framing. At naintindihan ko, syempre busy tayo sa international law, sa military affairs, AFP modernization. But I think hindi natin dapat take for granted, no? Speaking of complacency, totoo na 90%+ ng Filipino ay gusto nila mas malakas yung ating stance, proactive stance natin sa West Philippines. But we shouldn't take it for granted, right? Even that 90% could dissipate over time if we don't do our job.
Correct. Okay. When you mention also yung strategic culture, meron din tayong ano eh, yung that great divide na nakita ko that we need to address. It's that yung stovepipe of national security and yung understanding our economic, yung economics natin. Kasi those two cultures sa ating bureaucracy, hindi nag-uusap yan. Okay? So I think we need to look for that nexus wherein national security concerns and yung economic concerns natin nag-uusap para they sort of feed off each other. Okay? Right, example yung ano, yung sa reed bank, yung energy security issue doon because we need the replacement for Malampaya. Hindi masyadong nahihima yun. Okay? Kasi hindi naman ano eh, normally sa security service, hindi naman talaga hinihimay yung issues of economics. Eh. Unless magkaroon ng opportunity to interact with the other members of the bureaucracy that is focused on economy. So yun yung kailangan din makita. Ng kung sa bureaucracy natin may pagkukulang, ina-address natin yun, dapat ibaba rin natin yung diskurso sa publiko para makita rin nila yung nexus of security tsaka yung kanilang economic well-being. So yun yung nakikita ko rin. Pwedeng pag-usapan in future if there are opportunities or other forums na pwedeng pag-usapan.
Absolutely. And dami pa natin pwedeng pag-usapan in the context of West Philippines. Kaya dun sa susunod na episodes, gusto natin makuha ng mga economists, mga mangingisda, civil society, Catholic Church. So, malawak na issue ito, no? Admiral, I completely agree with you. Isingit ko lang ito. Siyempre ngayon may budget hearing, budget deliberation, kaya lumabas itong 10 million pesos isang kaibigan project ni Madam and all of that. To what degree is budget an issue pagdating sa defense of West Philippine Sea? To what degree is corruption still a concern in terms of preventing us from developing yung ating kakayahan pagdating sa pagdepensa ng ating karagatan, ating teritorya at soberenya? Anong base ni dyan, Admiral? How serious are those problems in terms of undermining yung ating national interest or yung position natin to protect our national interest?
Okay. When you talk about the budget, siyempre you want to be optimal in your ano, yung resources, no? Gusto mo makuha mo yan. But you have to be also a responsible ano, bureaucrat, kumbaga. Naintindihan naman natin that yung piece of the pie, there are also competing and equally important concerns na kailangan din tugunan ng gobyerno. Okay? For example, education, health. Okay? Naintindihan na natin yun. So, naintindihan din natin na ang kaya lang ng gobyerno is yung itong piece of the pie, ng pizza pie, that goes to the defense or sa military at saka sa other security services. Now, ang question, we always believe that the foundation of a robust military capability is a very robust economy. So, babalik tayo dun sa ano eh. Kailangan natin palakasin yung ating ekonomiya para magkaroon tayo ng resources para tama lang yung pagkakadepensa natin sa ating bansa. Okay. So, chicken and egg yan eh. Ano yung unahin mo? Guns versus butter. At some point, you have to make some calibrated choices kasi may opportunity cost involved dyan. Eh. Corruption, ang nakita ko kasi bago ako umalis ng service, and I, at some point I did my duty as ano as member of the Pigeon Award Committee sa headquarters. Nakita ko naman ano eh very may yung sistema very open and maraming check and balances to ensure that no corruption can seep in. I'm not saying na 100% wala. But I'm saying na as far as I'm concerned, ang nakita ko, the mechanisms in place were designed to prevent corruption.
Is this the result of the reforms during General Bautista, the whole Bayanihan, the Aquino administration? Because I know there was some efforts to further professionalize and tighten things up.
It was an incremental evolution of reforms that came in during time of President Cory, moving forward, even up to the time of President Pinoy. So daan-daan yun that it was adopted. I mentioned about the Pigeon Award Committee. So yung Pigeon Award na yun sa Department of National Defense, it's open to ano, meron andun yung COA eh, andun yung commission on ano, audit, may representative doon. May representative din yung civil society. They can come in anytime and sit. They are actually invited to sit in those meetings, no? Para ano, nakikita nila yung ano, paano yung usapan doon.
So may transparency, multi-stakeholder participation.
Yeah. May transparency siya. Okay. Of course, merong problema minsan sa bidding, but it's more of a technical issue rather than yung corruption issue. A technical issue that merong failed bids. Okay.
You mean procurement laws, yung mga ganun? Procurement laws, for instance?
Pag pumasok ang batas natin, it has impact on the ano. Kaya minsan, nadidelay yung proseso ng acquisition. It's not as fast as we want, but that's the trade-off we agreed on just to make sure na at least we address the issue of corruption dun sa process. Okay, not perfect, but
incremental improvement. So that hindi ibig sabihin yan hopeless case. I mean, you always hear this rhetoric, especially from some in the opposition, na Philippines is hopelessly corrupt, whatever. It's like, have you been around the world? Have you seen corruption scandals in Bangladesh, Malaysia, even some mga developed countries or more developed countries? We see all sorts of different corruption scandals. The Philippines is not singularly, exceptionally corrupt. There is corruption. It's serious, but it, you know, unti-unti inaayos din natin yan, and hopefully we move more in the right direction. Kanina lang kausap ko doon sa isang show ko naman si Dindo Manhid, no? And we're talking about how to make Philippines more investment friendly, the risking, yung mga ganyan-ganyan. So I think sometimes we don't give ourselves enough credit, no? Including doon sa AFP modernization, we have come a long way over the past 10 years, no, Admiral, in terms of modernizing our naval assets and even Air Force for that matter?
Okay, sa modernization naman, you must remember yung, although I never saw the list of yung, ano, yung Rehorizon program. It was
Yung
to be, I believe,
third
in the past
horizon
5 years.
Na ginawang 10 years, yung third third phase ng
Yung,
horizon.
yung Rehorizon list is actually, I believe, ano ito eh, combination ng yung remnants of the projects ng Horizon 2 na hindi natapos, hindi na-complete. Then yung Horizon 3 itself, pinag-merge yun. Then nag-review ulit sila kung ano yung i-maintain lang, tapos ano na yung hindi na itutuloy. Okay. That's the Horizon. So basically, it's ano, it's based on yung modernization plan or program, yung revised AFP modernization plan that we had several years ago. Ang nakikita ko lang dito, ano, concern is yung agility natin, yung sense of agility natin to address new threats, okay? And yung agility natin in terms of adapting new technology. Ang kasi ang perennial worry natin, if you are the planning, yung defense planner, is baka yung binibili mo ngayong equipment, by the time that you get it 5 years, 6 years down the road, obsolete na. Obsolete na siya. Tapos, there
may
are new...
overtake ng technological innovations and new
can be
military
technology yeah. Or it can be an innovation in warfighting that came about
yeah.
That actually debunks the need for that technology. Okay? So, pwedeng mangyari yun. And those, that is yung fear mo as a defense planner. Baka hindi na fit yung i-acquire mong gamit by the time that you receive it.
Kunyari, you're developing a certain aircraft and then new drones come that are very effective against large aircraft. So, sinayang mo lang buhay mo. Diba? Parang sinayang pera mo.
For example, ano, let's take the take case ng Ukraine-Russian conflict. Like, and I've given this lecture many times. Eh. Parang tingnan nyo yung Ukraine. It has na, no navy. It's nothing non-existent, but it has a Ukraine navy. And it was able to more or less defeat yung Russian Black Sea fleet without using any ships. Okay? What did they use? Drones. Okay, so nakita natin yung advent of drone technology has an asymmetric capability. What, kumbaga parang na-debunk niya yung ano eh, yung the use of large ships eh, for naval operations. Ano ba yung pinaunang pinalubog nila, yung flagship ng Black Sea Fleet, eh, yung Moskva. Okay. And that created a lot of moral problems for the Russian
military. And we saw earlier also with Saudi Arabia and Yemen, no, they have all these fancy toys and bugbug saradong both Emiratis and Saudis. Although I know that the criticism is baka incompetent lang yung mga armed forces na yan. But I think even there we saw the limitations of modern, even Western technology, forget about Russian technology. Yeah. I think it's a good segue dito sa West Philippine Sea. Pero last isisingit ko lang talagang, hindi naman kita pinapahamak, Admiral. But do you think there could be a threat of, I don't know, do you think China has an interest in feeding into or fueling mini civil war, let's say, if ever things really get out of control with the Dutertes? Let's say, papunta sa arrest ng mga Dutertes, ma-impeach si Sara, yung mga ganun. Imagine the worst case scenario in terms of like the ultimate outcome of what's happening right now. If all of these factors that are coming together, Qualcomm investigation, a potential ICC warrants of arrest, if all of these things come together, and then the Dutertes go bazooka or berserk. You think China will have an interest in sowing trouble in southern Philippines to bog us down in the same way that Malaysia? I mean, the reason I'm saying this is because Malaysia did that to us for decade after decade after decade because they were scared na if we're strong and not divided, then we'll be a threat to them in Sabah. Diba? And compared to Malaysia, China has so many vectors of influence that Malaysia never had. Especially back in the 70s or 80s.
Okay, your concern has merit. So I go back to I read something about yung tinatawag nating red theory of victory. Okay, yung red theory of victory has two components. The first one is fits your question mo. Ang red theory of victory component is if I can divide my enemy para mag-away-away sila, that's already a win for me. I don't have to go to war. Okay? If I have sufficiently destabilized my adversary to the point na na-distract na sila because of infighting and they're no longer focusing on me, I win already. Panalo na ako doon. The other aspect of...
that's a minimalist. Let's just say that's a minimalist approach, right? Right, yeah.
Okay. The other one, siguro, is the proper segue to yung West Philippine Sea is on escalation naman. If I can escalate it to the point na to the point that you are willing to give up your national interest because you're afraid that I will escalate situation further. So you'd rather give it up to make sure to de-escalate. Okay. And we've seen that happen. Okay. So those are the two components of red theory of victory in place. So yung the other one fits into yung question mo kanina. Is there a possibility? Of course, yes. It doesn't have to be a successful regime change if I follow yung logic ng question mo. It just needs to destabilize the country in a way na hindi tayo makatutok sa West Philippines.
And in Mindanao looks like a soft underbelly if I use the Churchillian description.
Yeah. And if you go back just a few years earlier, di ba, we were focused on the CPP, NP, NDF. Yung local communist movement as a threat for 5 decades. And for 5 decades, nobody's minding the store as far as defending yung ating territorial waters, yung exclusive economic zone natin. Kasi we were looking inward. Eh. If you're asking for an analogy, that's the best analogy for yung concern mo.
Now, speaking of this, what's happening in the West Philippines right now, obviously, medyo weird yung nangyari kasi the breaking news was being broken down as we were having conversation the other morning dun sa Autak Forum natin sa Adriatico Cafe. What was your initial read? And then now, let's say, 24 hours to 48 hours removed from the incident, how has your read of the situation evolved? First, in terms of the immediate implications, and at the same time, in terms of understanding of anong broader macro strategy ng China, dyan sa West Philippine Sea.
Okay, I think during the Otak Forum, I mentioned naman yung the way I constructed yung strategy ng China sa West South China Sea is they're after sea control of the entire body of water of South China Sea. Okay. So ang doon di sa yung nangyayari, we cannot isolate just yung incident sa Scarborough Shoal, sa Secret Thomas Shoal, then yung Sabina Shoal as separate incidents. They are part of one
ecosystem. The greater theater.
One theater of operations yan. Eh. Okay. Now, if we deconstruct yung Sabina Shoal incident, yung with our Coast Guard, I mentioned sa Utak Forum na it's the same playbook na ginamit nila sa Second Thomas Shoal. Ang point lang ni Ray, ni Yusek Jonathan was, ang mission ng dalawang barko was actually to resupply other islands and features. I think it was mentioned in the paper, yung Lawak at Panatag. Okay. But that's us. We know that yun yung mission doon. But if baliktarin mo yung mundo and look at it from the lens ng China, I think they were overthinking. They were thinking na we are trying to duplicate yung Sierra Madre tactic natin.
Paranoid sila in that sense.
They were thinking already na yung Teresa Magbanwa, ibibitch natin yun, ipipermanent na natin doon sa Sabina Shoal. So siguro ang nila, naisaan mo na ako, kami, hindi kita pala dalawahin. Okay? Maaring yun ang calculation nila. And again, if we use yung Second Thomas Shoal playbook nila, remember, I think we had this podcast before, sabi ko, dineconstruct natin yung what is Second Thomas Shoal. So we occupy the inside the shoal through yung Sierra Madre, But we do not control the waters around the Second Thomas Shoal kasi andun yung presence ng Coast Guard and Militia. The third component nung system na yon is yung mobility corridor linking yung Sierra Madre to Pinlan, Palawan. And nagko-connect sa kanya yung resupply ship o yung resupply boat. In this case, if you go to Second Thomas Shoal, ang tinitira palagi ng China yung resupply boat. Meaning yung sustainment capability. So dito, if we, look at it, yung nangyari sa, no, sa Binas Shoal, and kung ang they were thinking na if this is going to be a Sierra Madre Part 2, ano tinira nila? Yung dalawang Coast Guard ship that are operating as resupply vessels.
So ang tingin nila ngayon, Coast Guard is kind of joining Navy in helping, you know, fortifying our military presence on the ground. Parang ganun yung basa nila. Yung basa mo sa nila.
I think they were trying, they were mirror imaging eh. They were trying to tama yung
project their own what they would have done in our place.
Kaya talagang niram nila yung dalawang Coast Guard vessels. Now, kung na-pin down nila yon, babalik ano yon, hindi natin magagamit yon kasi the vessels need to go on repair. So for that period, unless the Coast Guard is able to replace the two vessels with the new ones, but I would expect kapag pinalitan yon, ganun nang gagawin nila ulit.
Ganun nga, gagawin nila. And you were saying mission kill could be one of their, I mean, to degrade our capability for resupply and patrol could be also one of the upshots of their strategy, or part of their strategy, rather.
Yeah, mission kill is, I coined the word mission kill tactic. Basically, it's addressed to yung barko. Kung hindi nila ma-perform yung mission niya because of derangement o nasira siya. In this case, nabutasan yung barko, obviously, babalik mo yan sa, ano, kailangan mo siya mag-undertake na repair. So for the period na hindi natin siya magamit, that we lose that opportunity to use that vessel for those type of missions. Okay. Alam ko, sampu lang yung ganun type of vessel. So, kung ulit-ulitin lang yung tactic niya, maubusan tayo na lang. In like manner, naubusan tayo na lang.
So in that sense, obviously, my position is Transparency Initiative has its own value. It has helped us to mobilize public support, get the basic facts right. At the same time, I see the value of the AFP not asking yung tulong galing sa US in a sense that we can handle it ourselves. But if the current trend lines continue and your mission kill hypothesis reaches the next logical conclusion, then medyo ang langanin tayo, no, Admiral? I mean, what kind of adjustments or upscaling we may need in the coming months para siguraduhin natin na ma-maintain at preserve natin yung position natin on the ground? We have like, what, 8 features to protect at least?
I think we also discussed this before. Yung option natin is looking at larger commercial-type vessels that we can lease, then later on maybe buy, and may repurpose or commission as naval vessels or Coast Guard vessels. Kasi yung labanan dito, palakihan ng barko eh, kung makikita mo. Ang nadadali sa atin, yung ating mga maliliit na barko eh, they're not equipped for yung...
44 meters pa yung mga tinamaan? Were they like 44?
44 meters yun eh. And you actually need those 44 meters kasi sila yung nakakapasok sa loob ng shoal. Okay? Kasi medyo ano eh, medyo mababaw. Their portions mababaw. Tsaka mas mabilis sila. So, merong utility kung bakit ganun type of vessels ang ginagamit natin. But of course, it lends itself to certain vulnerabilities. Kagaya nga no, dinikitan sila, niram sila na mas malaking Coast Guard vessels. Obviously, yung impact no, we create that yung damage na nakita natin sa dalawang barko.
What about the aspect of the, I know inuulit natin yan, but medyo nakakatakot na nangyari to. Do you think we should really adjust yung MDT natin to deal also with gray zones? I mean, how can the US be helpful? How can our allies be helpful in dealing with these kinds of gray zones? This is very, very aggressive. At least nagsalita na yung mga ibang bansa after this incident. Kasi timing sila after yung aircraft incident last week sa Panatak Shoal. Eh.
Yung sa akin kasi, Richard, bago natin, sa akin kasi last option yung MDP. Kapag extreme case na yun. Eh. Ba, sa akin kasi parang, ang tanong ko is, baka kailangan mag-adjust tayo muna ng tactics. Mag-adjust muna tayo ng tactics bago tayo mag-call for call a friend. Okay. Kasi, ang nakita ko rito, we are using tactics that we kumbaga basang-basa na talaga ng kabila.
Na-exhaust na yung ano niya, yung yeah.
Tapos pag in-escalate nila, ang parang ang default mode natin is look for ways to de-escalate. Balik tayo sa Red Theory Victory. Pag pinush comes to shove ko, in-escalate ko na escalate, then mahina loob mo. Ang gagawin mo is not to escalate, it's to de-escalate. At some point, when you de-escalate, you might be compelled to give up ano yung pinoprotektahan mo eh. Okay. In this case, if we follow the playbook under using yung lente ng kabila, ang visioning nila rito is ano ba objective nila? Pauwiin yung Teresa Magbantua eh. Okay. Yun yung ano nila eh. But if we do that, tapos walang replacement that creates a vulnerability, papasukan na nila yon. Kasi one thing also I learned during my past life sa Naval Forces West, pag nagpakita ka ng interest sa isang area, tapos hindi mo siya pinurso, papasukan na nila yon.
Oh, kung hindi mo pinanindigan.
Kasi,
yeah.
Kasi in-expose mo na yung sarili mo na importante sa iyo yun. Eh. Okay. So, uunahan ka na nila doon. Dito, whether we like it or not, pinakita natin, critical yung sabihin na show sa atin. And tama lang naman, kasi 75 nautical miles from mainland Palawan. Eh. So, kung makita tayo ng butas niya, let's say, for some reason, we are forced to pull out Teresa Magbanwa without any replacement, papasukan na nila yan, hindi na nila bibitawan yan. Scarborough Shoal scenario ano natin. Yung pupuntahan natin dyan.
Ako naman kasi, Admiral, it's not about calling the friend. It's about using the calling the friend card in a more effective way. If I can put it that way, di ba? So for instance, we have this new $500 million defense aid package. Ambassador Maldes told me the last week during sa interview natin on this show na, you know, we're looking at up to $3 billion total package of defense aid over the next 4 or 5 years. So my sense is, there's a lot of focus on AFP modernization, Coast Guard modernization. That's great, but that's a little bit long term, right? There has to be also more focus on the short term, immediate responses. And so far, it's Japan was the most useful to us in a sense that tinulungan talaga yung Philippine Coast Guard, binigyan radar system ng AFP, and of course, there's also India and South Korea helping. But I'm not sure US has been anywhere close to where it could have been in terms of being optimally helpful to us as an ally. Parang hindi commensurate. Eh. Again, it's not about begging our friends. It's not about calling in your friends. In fact, it's just about making sure you're using what you got there, because we shouldn't be alone in this fight, and we should have some element of deterrence after all, if we have this alliance and friends and all. Or my sense is, you guys think I'm just asking too much or I'm pushing it too much.
Tama naman, but ang problema kasi ganito, it's more of an issue of logistics. Yung ino-offer nila is something that we either we do not need or we cannot sustain. Okay, that's why we're looking at other partners in terms of yung in sa acquisition natin, because they can provide us the equipment that we need at the cost that we are affordable to us, and still yung utility niya magagamit talaga natin. So, alam naman natin na US standard of equipment medyo quite expensive. Okay. So, kung meron man ayuda na galing sa kanila for supporting our defense posture, siguro magsa-cycle back yan doon sa acquisition ng equipment nila na kailangan natin. Siguro, let's take an example of, although the cost itself is yung funding itself may not be sufficient. Let's say if the Air Force is looking at acquiring an F-16. So, kung yung perang yung support na in-offer ng US can be used to jumpstart yung acquisition of F-16. That's one.
So, you're saying it should be a full package of support. Or what about, I don't know, asking Denmark to give some of their used F-16s to us now still could be very helpful. Not US directly, but asking NATO friends, NATO allies to do that in our behalf, because they all want to move to F-35 or whatever, right?
I think pwede naman eh. If we acquire, let's say, for example, lang, this is just an example, an F-16 from other countries, not the US. Yung improvement ng system ma rin, can, the funding coming from the US can be used to support the improvement ng aircraft na yun. Okay, so if it's a, it's a, an earlier model, parang bumili ka ng kotse na ano eh, na lumang model, para ma-upgrade yon, the funding that we're going, potentially we're getting can be used to upscale o upgrade yung nabili mong equipment. Okay. Doon pwede pumasok yon.
I mean, do you think the F-16 is really worth it? I mean, it's for me kasi parang naging ano na siya eh, totemic na siya eh. Parang I've been seeing all of these fantasies of Philippines Air Force with the F-16s and all of that. Like a lot of defense geek people have been discussing it, a lot of media coverage over it. It almost have a, has a totemic value, which of course is weird because this is a very old technology in comparison. We don't even have a single multi-role vessel and a multi-role fighter, sorry, multi-role fighter yet, na legit. So even that is a big deal for a lot of us.
Well, of course, I'll defer to the Air Force guys to whether that's the right platform for us. No? I just use it as an example kasi yun na yung ano yung prevalent sa defense community conversations eh, yung F-16. It could be something else. Okay. But kung babalikan natin yung ano yung discussion natin about the Ukraine-Russian conflict and yung lessons learned doon. Well, to make a distinction between the platform and the platform as a delivery system at saka yung munition itself, yung weapon itself. Okay. Ang beauty ng drone kasi it's both the delivery platform, the delivery system, at saka rin yung munition mo. When you take the example of yung F-16, the F-16 is a platform. That's your delivery system. But yung munition mo is yung payload niya ng ano ng missiles na nakakabit doon. So that means kung from a perspective of cost, you're buying two systems na nakabery. The delivery platform, which is the aircraft, and the munitions, which is the missile. Okay? But if we go into the conversation of, I think I mentioned it during the forum, when we look at the when we try to review yung modernization, maybe we can look at yung answer the question of how do we fight more cheaper? Cheap in
More
you
cheaper,
think
better, more effectively also.
yeah, pero more effective. Okay. More effective. That's why a best example for that would be the drone again. As a cheap solution, but effective siya. Okay. Kasi mahirap yung ano, uunahan mo na I want this type of system without understanding saan yung tanong mo dapat eh, saan mo ba gagamitin yan? Ano ba yung number one challenge mo sa area mo? If I look at it from a sa lente ng ni from a naval lens, ang existential challenge natin sa West Philippine Sea are yung Navy, Philippine Navy, Chinese Coast Guard, saka yung militia. We partially solved that when we acquired yung BrahMos missile system from India, although hindi pa siya 100% na deliver. May it's not being brought in as fast as we would like it to be. Okay? So technically nandiyan na siya pero hindi pa siya up and running. I'm not familiar
Pero
kung
siya
anong challenge.
fully operational.
Oh, hindi pa siya fully operational. But that is one solution. Kasi that for with that system, we don't need a ship. We don't need to buy a ship to address yung problem. But it's a very expensive system, and I think you will reserve that for high-value targets. Okay, you don't use that to hit a militia vessel kasi sabi ko nga, yung return of investment mo dun sa system versus yung target mo, lubi ka. Okay, if you remember, yung analogy ko is pag pinato ka ng 100 pesos, maghanap ka ng pambabato mo na 10 piso lang. Okay.
So,
para
mas
yung
masakit yung 10 piso kasi coin siya, di ba?
yes.
Pinadulang ko talaga yung metaphor mo. Parang masakit talaga yung 10 pesos. Kasi 100 pesos, papel lang eh. Kung naman, Admiral.
Pero wala, hindi mo na bato yung 100 pesos. Masakit na yun.
Gusto natin ganun.
Pinalo.
In 11 days, magbabato ako ng 150 million. No? Ayun ang gusto kong pangbato sa'yo, Admiral. Pero sa Admiral, ganito na lang ha. You know where I'm coming from. Obviously, you can... Someone watching us could easily say, yeah, you can see the guy below is the amateur because he's all about big, I mean, he's about big strategy. But the other guy is the real expert kasi logistics siya. But the reason why I think I'm a bit justified pa rin nevertheless, because I'll defer to you on logistical questions, is because, Admiral, I think there should be some element of symbolism of modernization, a performativity, because as critical as I am of populist performativity and all of that, because kulang tayo sa self-confidence, di ba? I mean, I've met many Filipinos who don't even know na meron na tayong modern warships. I mean, relatively modern, yung mga nakuha natin sa Korea, di ba? Yung, you know, I wrote some of them in Philippine Navy, yung BRP Rizal, among other things. Eh, medyo legit. These are pretty good stuff, di ba? With good electronics, missile systems, radar systems. Not there, but good enough for me. So I think you need some of this flashy stuff, if I can put it, no? To just create this kind of a mindset na mahalaga yung national defense, mahalaga yung self-reliance. And going back to what we're saying, hindi dapat parati umasa tayo sa US guns or other guns, that we can also develop a decent version of our own. The second aspect to this, Admiral, and I push back slightly here, is I get all your point about, good luck naman, parang bumili ka ng Lamborghini, wala kang parking. But minsan, pag bumili ka ng Lamborghini, maganahan ka maghanap din ng parking. Ang dami kong kilalang tao, bumili ng kotse, tapos doon pa lang, kumukuha ng lisensya. Kasi sayang, di ko magamit ang kotse ko. Excited na ako. Di tuloy, bigla nag-aaral na ng ano. Nag-aaral na kasi tinatamad driving school. So, sometimes, you know, you could put the cart before the horse and it might work, right? So I don't know. Maybe I'm sounding ridiculous, Admiral. But ako kasi, I'm active on social media. I deal with people, I deal with politics, public relations. Sa tingin ko, medyo kulang talaga tayo ng that, you know, that kind of pizzazz, that kind of vibes of self-confidence. That's why I keep on talking about F-16s. I know it sounds amateurish na ganun, but I see the value. I see the value. It has this kind of a rallying effect. I mean, why would even BBM go to the FA-50 and do all of that vlog and all of that? Because he also realizes there's a value to strengthening yung confidence ng ating kababayan sa Armed Forces of the Philippines and our upward trajectory in how we have to move. Kasi rallying effect din yan, di ba? Am I being out of my depths here, Admiral? Do you think I'm blabbering here, bloviating?
Okay. Siguro, ang malapit-lapit dun sa sinasabi mo is what I would deem to be yung high-low fleet. Okay. High-low fleet is a mix of yung high-end vessels, very expensive, has the bells and whistles na gusto mo. The low one is the low-end type. These are yung pang-araw-araw mong ano. Okay? Pang-araw-araw mo. So if you have enough money and you buy cars, so meron ka Lamborghini, pero meron ka rin Toyota.
Yun yung everyday mo. Tapos yung Lamborghini, labas mo lang pag may gawin kang special.
Oo, pero yung Toyota mo, marami yun. Okay? Marami yun. Yung Lamborghini mo siguro, isa o